far, they hate it, they never believe me. Yeah, I would never drop the ball, I know I make it look easy. Yeah, Mayweather with the defense. I don't care what a critic gotta say, I got him picking up the pieces. Hey, please don't play no games with me, I promise I'm too much. Hey, I can never let up even if you had enough. Hey, this ain't for the faint of heart, we always playing rough. I had enough, it ain't luck.
Welcome to Round Rock, Texas for the MCLA National Tournament. We have a second round matchup today between the Golden Eagles of Concordia Irvine and the Georgia Tech Yellow Jackets. Both teams having success yesterday and getting to continue their season today. I'm joined by John Robinette. This is Patrick Franklin. John, what are your keys to the game today for these squads?
Starts with the face-off X. Yesterday, Concordia cruised and won that battle, winning 88% of their draws. Now, granted, Northeastern was missing their number one face-off man. So that's going to be a big battle right there for possessions. And looks like Concordia wins the first one on a procedural call.
Yeah, ball settled in here on the offensive side as we see Concordia get their first line midfield in. That's going to be Tyler Collins, Nick Beeson, and Jeremy Barnes now with the ball up over the top. We saw this group do a lot of dodging this high wing as they are here to put a lot of pressure on the defense to slide off of that near side man, as we see there, we're not able to connect the pass. Did a great job of initiating its short sticks and then playing freely out of it. I think both squads, you'll see a similar kind of game plan in terms of being methodical in the first little bit of their possessions and then having free play out of it.
Jeremy Barnes with a big game yesterday for the Eagles. 3 goals on the night. Played a huge part. As well as Tyler Collins, 2 goals, 2 assists last night. So I would look to see those two players having success if the Golden Eagles are going to have some success.
Collins pulling it off his right hand. He showed success shooting with both his right and left hands. Only got 10 seconds left in the shot clock here, as it's been a pretty good first possession from the Golden Eagles. Shot just wide. And that's going to be our first shot clock violation of the day.
Yeah, great defensive stand there by Georgia Tech. Got to get a lot of confidence. Georgia Tech had the easier route to this game today, you know, cruising to a 17-9 victory over University of Texas. Yellow Jackets able to rest several of their guys, and so on paper they would seem to be the fresher team for today.
Yeah, absolutely. We see Georgia Tech going to that same kind of action where they're trying to initiate on that high wing, taking longer distances for the defense to have to slide and help support on ball as they push the ball through X and back up to the opposite wing. Quarles pushes the wing, looks to roll back. Gets the ball back up top. Brooks Barrow with this dodge here. He had a great game yesterday. Powerful right-handed player. But that ball is snuffed out in the middle, and now Yang is looking to clear it with his Golden Eagles.
Yeah, Georgia Tech, very balanced on offense. I mean, they had 7 different goal scorers, including Barrow with 2 goals, 1 assist, who you just mentioned.
I think a big piece of this game will come down to the ability to ride and clear the ball. If you saw the first couple clears here so far, on a good shot and backup gotten quickly there by Chad McFadden. Great effort by him. But going back to the clearing game and the riding game, yesterday we saw Concordia get a lot of opportunities to clear the ball easily. Georgia Tech, on the other hand, was able to corral and force the Longhorns into some extended possessions defensively because they weren't able to clear the ball out first time. So we'll see how that transition game and those decisions in the transition game will make an effect on this game. Great initiation from that top wing there. Skip look over to Beeson, and Beeson hits a step down, pipe to in. Great shot by the kid to get the Golden Eagles up 1-0.
Yeah, two offensive possessions, and we see kind of the same play with Jeremy Barnes dodging down that right side, turning back, looking across, and he's able to find Beeson on that backside, who, like you said, rips a step downer and just right over the head of Zagrobelny.
Yes, both these goalies, Zagrobelny and Yang, played a really good games yesterday. Been a theme throughout the tournament. I'm excited to see how these shooters settle in and look to shoot through and around screens or use change of direction or change of angle on their shots in order to get better chances to score on these goalies.
So here we are with our second faceoff, Pizak versus Kaiser.
Kaiser had a lot of success last night against Northeastern, but here we go. Fast break the other way. Pizak looks at Ken. He had two goals yesterday.
Yeah, for sure. As a faceoff guy, you got to love that. Actually had one, I think, left-handed and one right-handed.
Yeah, he's balanced breakfast over there at the Georgia Tech house.
He comes off the field with a big smile on his face after that shot.
It's a possession shot, Coach. We're good. Open set here, a little bit different start here for Georgia Tech.
Yeah, asking Coach Lovick before the game kind of what they were going to be focused on, and he was pretty straightforward. He says, you know, we're going to focus on us, as we've done all year. We don't try to change things up. We try to do what we do best, and that's balance the offense out, spread it ball, move it quick, and finish shots.
Wagnon getting to the middle there, but unfortunately collapsed on, I think there was a push call, so it'll be a clock reset and a fresh 80 seconds for the Yellow Jackets, and unfortunately they turn that ball over there.
Yeah, tough pass by Quarles. A little underhand and just over the reach of his teammate.
This will be the first time we see Brady Galbraith into the game as they look to change up the midfield a little bit. Beeson going to take a rest here after getting his goal-scoring chances going, but we're going to probably see the same kind of action, and if not, look for them to do what they're doing right now and invert this action to see if they can draw defensive support. And unfortunately for Georgia Tech, the defensive support wasn't quick enough as the Golden Eagles get to the rack and Jerry Barnes gets his first of the day. He's been initiating a lot for them early.
Yeah, Barnes picking up right where he left off last night, as we mentioned, with the hat trick last night. Now he's already off with assist and a goal. Another great dodge, and this time from the left side of the field, and just kind of turns. Rather than finding a man on the back side, he elects to shoot himself and has a great release and just a quick shot.
You'll usually see teams go to slide quickly when you get into that invert situation, as we see the Yellow Jackets get this one. That's going to be a big matchup all day. The wing play as well is going to be a big factor.
Absolutely. Young, number 88 for Concordia, played a huge role in that face-off success on those wings.
Yeah, I'm a huge fan of Young. He had a great take and transition last night to get an assist. As we see Georgia Tech sweeping over the top, we saw that again yesterday too. That's going to be Devin Ron. He was having a day yesterday, using that big, thick frame to punch into the defenseman's hands and clear his own. Great sweep dodge there.
Yeah, that was a great finish. Nice left. Coach Lovick mentioning Devin Ron by name when I asked him about anybody standing out yesterday, and he just mentioned that Devin had been kind of battling injuries a lot of the year and was kind of been mainly used on their extra man unit, but he's feeling 100% and healthy and back in the starting lineup, and that's given him a lot of juice. And yeah, four goals yesterday, and starts the scoring for the Yellow Jackets today.
That was a changeup at the faceoff X for the Golden Eagles. Good securing of the ball as we see Beeson moving the ball up over the top.
It looked like Cade Poe taking that face off. And
Cade Poe, captain, junior captain. Great first face off for him as he's now fighting to get off the field early and see if he can get his team some opportunities in transition.
Looked like Barnes almost had a step on there, but a good recovery by Beeson.
Yeah, so we got Beeson, Collins, and again, initiating the entire offense right now is Jeremy Barnes as he looks, move it across, Collins to Beeson. Beeson will initiate on this high wing. great job fading the threat line there, but unfortunately, Collins unable to secure the pass, and we've got a fast break the opposite direction. Oh, and there he is again for his second of the game.
Yeah, again, coach was spot on, talking about the juice that that Ron can bring to this team. All starts from that defensive end, though. Great pickup by Kevin Lowe, the captain out of Islip, New York, bringing that ball across and finding Ron on the backside.
That's so tough. Concordia, no stranger to that. You know, turnover at the top of the box led to their win in the fourth quarter. Very emotional win for them, and really excited to see Obispo in that situation getting that opportunity. But now it's Tech moving the ball up the field in the clearing game. You see Golden Eagles dropping into this 3-3 zone ride, trying to eliminate any transition opportunities over the top. But Tech with that nice job of stretching that last defender over the midline before the clock expired.
Yeah, you mentioned that victory last night by Concordia. A lot of motion in that game. You know, minute 49, and they get a player go down, you know, Nolan Folsom. And so I'm happy to report that Nolan on the sideline today with his teammates. Just a little banged up, a little sore, but should be making a full recovery.
Can't see a number on that
20.
One.
2-3.
Was that Grasso?
Yeah.
Let's go. Get on the board, kid.
Yeah, Grasso with the goal there out of Wellesley's Mass. Just a sophomore.
Georgia Tech roster has kids from all over the United States, and that's such a great school. You can understand why. A lot of kids wanting to get great engineering degrees, and can't blame them for that, can you? So we have players shaking up on the play, but coming off under his own power, Justin Defoe, senior LSM. Good to see him moving in the right direction after that play there.
So they're bringing Poe in again. You know, both of those, Poe and Kaiser took, you know, the bulk of the faceoffs, and Poe actually taking, you know, 261 on the regular season. Last night they were featuring Kaiser much more prevalently.
It's always good to have the ability to change the matchup at the faceoff X. You know, it's kind of similar to having running backs in the NFL. You want to have a speed guy, you want to have a power guy. That's certainly the case. You know, there's different techniques that could be successful against different opponents, and we're seeing right now that the Golden Eagles are having success with that matchup with Poe.
Here we go with Barnes on that side, initiating again. That looks to be their MO today.
Barnes to Beeson, see the double coming in. Beeson continues to carry. Nice physical dodge by Beeson, but the defense up to the task.
Yeah, great recovery there by Ian Balzer. Kind of to force that over. And a swarming D right there. You know, Matt Seifert, second midfielder, coming up with that ball. And pushing in transition.
We saw Tech get a lot of opportunities getting to the middle yesterday against Texas. I'm not so certain that that's going to be happening today against Concordia. I think they're going to be, after, you know, getting to see that game, scouting them, get to see that they need to support the adjacent gaps and protect the middle of the field, as we see a feed very reminiscent of last night's game, again to the middle of the field. If you're a defender and you're trying to defend Devin Ron on that high wing, what would you suggest, you know, doing there? If you're coaching up the Eagles here, what would you try to tell them about, you know, containing that lefty?
Well, I would definitely try to force him to his weaker hand and try to keep him out of the middle of the field so he doesn't have the best angles. Mm-hmm. First save of the game right there for Young. That was a doozy right on the doorstep with the BTB.
Yeah, that was great. Got nice angle on the shot, and Yang up to the task there. I don't know who finished that, but that was a great opportunity right there. I think that was Quarles inside. They had that action a lot last night, whether it was off the end line or off of man-up plays. They were constantly looking to get the ball down to that wing and then feed back into the middle of the teeth of the defense. Great action for them, for sure.
Yeah, last night they had Georgia Tech had two behind-the-back goals that looked highlight reels, real-ish.
And they're both the right play.
Yeah, absolutely.
Both right play in terms of the angle. Well, we got a timeout here. Coach Levick and Georgia Tech want to talk it over. We got 5:48 left in the first quarter. Score of 3-2. I think it'd be a great time to mention that if you're following along, you can see that hashtag in the corner of the screen. The hashtag for this game is going to be CUI versus GT. If you're following along and want to tweet at us, some of those tweets can be featured in the broadcast, and we might shout out some fans that are supporting these players. If you've got any fun facts or any loving facts to share about some of these kids, we'd love to highlight them in any way we can. We had last night in our game had two Boston Marathon finishers, was the word on the street, and found out that was actually after a doubleheader game for Northeastern, which is even more impressive. I don't know how you could stand doing that, but God bless them. These athletes are definitely worthy of praise, and we're excited to see what they have in store for us in the last three quarters of this game. All right. Looks like we've got our pieces set. Counting 6-on-6, so we're all good to go here. Let's see if there's a wrinkle here from the Golden Eagles coming out of this timeout as we see Georgia Tech with the midfield line of Barrow, Witten, and Lucas over the top. Ooh, a good little seal fade action on that backside. Big Quarles off the face, off the wing.
Yeah, Quarles looking to distribute. You know, you've seen him make a lot of passes already this quarter on that backside for some quality shots.
Death taxes. My man Devin Ron getting to the middle.
And Ron across the middle.
I mean, it's tough. It's really tough. As a righty, you want to take that slap check and really punish them, but big guys like that, they're just going to kind of laugh on their way to the cage as they feel that check go and then leave. Barrow there looks inside to Quarles. Quarles off the pipe. That's going to be a reset, but swarming defense there by Young.
A great effort, individual effort there by Quarles to get that one back. Keep the possession, keep another possession alive.
This is now a third set of time, right? They've had two resets so far in this shot clock. This is really draining on a defense. You know, you can really grind teams down with this methodical type of offense, which we've seen Georgia Tech do in this tournament yesterday against Texas. And again, with the clock reset, let's see if Young tries his best to get that ball, but Barrow up to the task. Good physicality and good double there. Oh, just unable to handle it.
Yeah, great double there by Abispo coming in there.
Those have to be two of the best defenders playing midfield, probably of any squad here. Both extremely physical, great footwork between Young and Abispo. You know, really fun watching those guys play the game.
Yeah, Bispo not the biggest guy out there by any means, but super strong, super quick.
Good backup there.
Yeah, Barrow trying a little bit of a question mark dodge.
It's early in these games, this possessions like this are like body shots in boxing. You know, you just continue to just possess the ball, make them slide, rotate, recover, and. And there's the haymaker on that right hook as Quarles finds his way up over the top with his favorite left hand right over the goalie's shoulder. Tough one for Yang.
Yeah, Quarles likes to shoot on that one instead of looking to feed. And still with that kind of three-quarter release, a little kind of low to high, as you mentioned, and beats Young to give the Yellow Jackets a two-goal advantage. Oh, excuse me, goalie Yang. Fault, Daniel.
We got Young and Yang. Young is 88.
Yeah.
Baller. Both are ballers, to be fair. Nice pass there. Cade Poe making an impact on this game big time so far.
Absolutely.
Got three so far for him?
I've got four. Four to three right now in the faceoff battle unofficially. If you're Concordia here, I would try to get a little bit sustained possession, just give your defense a little rest. I mean, like you said, they just played kind of four clock resets down there, and so they got to be gassed a bit, you know, give them a breather.
Yeah, I like to see Georgia Tech not following the same method that Northeastern did. They're not choosing to double pull the midfield, which means that There will be a defenseman guarding Andrew Buckley. Oh my, but they might change it pretty soon here as Beeson gets his second.
Yeah, Beeson makes him pay. Just that little stutter step right there, just enough to release his hands. And man, what a quick shot he got off there. Again, choosing to shoot high. I don't have any saves down for Zachary Bellamy yet.
They're coming. Oh, they yeah. are coming. If what we saw yesterday and throughout the regular season is any indication, great, great young goaltender and certainly a resilient one at that. But so far, if you think back to what our game was yesterday, Texas had success shooting high and shooting off of those bouncers, as we see Poe with a third consecutive faceoff win, his fourth of the day, which makes it five total for the Golden Eagles. And this is where you really like to see your offense impose their will and try to get a little bit more production, as we see Garrett Burns getting onto the field for the first time, moving the ball across, and immediately starting offensive action. Interesting tactic here. I see that now Beeson is playing at the attack. Maybe rest him while keeping on a shooter?
Yeah, you know, at this level, I mean, these offensive players, they could play attack, they could play midfield. A lot of coaches want to kind of move them around, keep other teams guessing.
Zone. We got our first zone of the day. See if they can identify it. It's not a 3-3 garden variety zone that Georgia Tech runs, so it's hard to tell at times, but you can see by based on the matchups on the field where they're sitting.
Oh.
Man, that was a good take right there.
Got a hat trick for
Beeson again.
Beeson, yeah.
Man, Beeson.
And Garrett Burns with the assist. That
Beeson
was a good
is
look.
Not a small individual, and Garrett Burns makes him look tiny.
Yeah,
those two hugging after the play, and it's like, man, what is going on over there in the gene pool? Great take there, but it'd be interesting to see. I'm going back to my point. Last night, the hero, Andrew Buckley, scored that game winner. He was getting a short stick treatment from the University of Texas. It'll be interesting to see if they choose to do that same tactic again. He had a short stick on him for a short time there. And Poe back again at the faceoff X. I mean, this is – I don't remember seeing him much at all last night. Maybe it's just me being so locked in.
He took some, but it was mainly Kaiser that was
Kaiser having a lot of success
last night. But we're going to see our first penalty here. We got a flag down. It's going to be a slash to the head on Georgia Tech.
Did you see Obispo?
So, yeah, the Eagles content here to kind of work it around and get a quality shot off. Uh-huh.
Got a reset. Would love to see them be patient with this offensive possession here, knowing they're going to get the ball back. They can really tire out the core of this defense.
To me, I just saw another one on the head, but.
We got a great staff here, great crew here. We got two Texas officials as well as a Minnesota official, so really getting, you know, the geographic mix here, which we like. But we've had great officiating this week throughout the entire tournament, and seeing that so far again today, officials doing a great job of keeping these players safe while also keeping the game flowing in a timely manner, and we really appreciate that. Pretty awesome to see them work.
That slash was on number 11, Pizak, Georgia Tech's faceoff guy. He got kind of caught out there on the defensive end.
First man up opportunity we see for the Golden Eagles. McFadden not able to handle that one. A lot of physicality, as you can expect, in a winner-go-home game. But a pickoff on the defensive end for the Eagles. That was a great individual effort there.
McFadden-wise to kind of pull that one out, get his man up, set back going. Collins up top at the point, running things.
Interesting to see Beeson playing the lefty pinch spot over there instead of being that righty shooting spot more so.
Yeah, if we notice, all the goals, four goals so far for Concordia have been up high. Mm. I think, as we saw yesterday, Georgia Tech's goalie was very stout on those low bouncers.
Which is uncommon for such a big guy, right? You see tall, you think you can't really shoot up there because that's where he's standing. With deflection there as a penalty is released.
That was a great no-look pass by Tyler Collins down to McFadden, who got the shot off but got a little deflection.
I'm thinking McFadden might get lost in the wash here in a little bit. You know, he's a guy that's a very prolific scorer. for this group. I think he was their leading scorer throughout the season. I think it was some like 70 points throughout the season, right? So look for all this action on the righty side of the field to get all the lefty action lost in the wash for some of maybe these skip passes as we see what looks to be a zone. Hard to tell with how good of defensive support Georgia Tech plays with.
Well, it's a great job by the extra man unit. Or excuse me, the man down unit for Georgia Tech.
And that's going to be at the end of the first quarter. All tied up 4-4. It's been a fun one so far. I think for me, the story of the game so far has been the competition at the face-off X. Super impressive job by the Golden Eagles and Poe so far, especially considering the dominance that Georgia Tech had yesterday. Well, I guess actually percentage-wise, not necessarily that much dominance, but clamp at least, clamp win percentage that we saw from them yesterday. That's going to be my biggest takeaway so far. Those extra possessions really going to mean a lot in such an airtight game.
Yeah, absolutely. 6-3. Advantage of Concordia on the faceoffs. I've been impressed with Beeson for, you know, Nick Beeson, the junior, or excuse me, the grad student midfielder. And as you mentioned, they've kind of been putting him down low a little bit, playing in that kind of attack role, coming from midi. They've just kind of been moving him around. So he's had a hat trick in the first quarter. He's been hard to stop.
Yeah, for sure. You see, and one thing I love about the game of lacrosse is just that, you know, there's no one body type. Obviously, you have to be athletic. Any sport, you know, that you're playing, athleticism is probably the single most important category. But because of the decision-making and the skill level that's necessary for the game of lacrosse, you could have a guy like a Nick Beeson, 6'2", I mean, tall drink of water, just as effective as a guy like, say, Quarles for the other team. You know, it's how you see the game, and it's how you move the pieces, but there's also really no substitute for that leverage that you can get for a 6'2", 6'3", 6'4 frame. I mean, you're pulling from a much different angle, and so you can get a lot more force in the ball.
Yeah, lacrosse doesn't have one standard prototypical body type that you need, kind of as like, you know, basketball or football.
Sure.
You know, tall, short. But as you mentioned, the athleticism and the eye-hand coordination just really separates these athletes.
Beeson going back down to the tack.
As we see Poe squaring off against Pizak to start the second quarter.
Oh, great hockey play by Poe there.
Oh, relentless by Young to come up with that, get the ball on the turf and scoop it up.
The field is starting to get a little bit tilted in the possession game. Going to be on Zagrebelny and this defense to try to force some turnovers or make some saves to try to get their team back in the positive of that possession column.
Yeah, Tech knew that coming in, that it was going to be a battle, and you know, he was hoping to get some 50-50 ground balls. Oh, wow.
My, oh my. What's up, young fella? Let's go.
Yeah, that's
that was a great play, but you heard the coaching staff over here. Coach Foss, the coaching staff, said, no, 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 stay on. I think they noticed they had an advantage in transition. They had subbed on, and they had a 6-on-5. What a smart play by Young to continue to hold on to that ball, look off his point man, get the defender to slide and hold there so he could shoot that. And again, where was the placement on the shot, John?
High.
Off stick high.
But, yeah, that was a great kind of substitution play, as you mentioned. It gave him an advantage with the numbers. Young acting like he's running off, and his defender was following him, and then he just stopped, turned around, and got the ball back, and rather than distribute, just ripped it.
And a great job there, Georgia Tech, getting their first faceoff win of the quarter. And oh boy,
who else?
Not just a lefty. Don't put me in that box. All right, that was an awesome finish from a low angle, right over the shoulder of Yang. And it was like you were talking about yesterday. Some of these shooters are doing a great job of using deception in their shooting techniques. Tell me, John, what are some things that these shooters are doing in terms of being deceptive that are giving them success like that against these goalies?
Well, dipping your shoulder down a little bit, maybe looking low with your eyes, just kind of trying to hide that stick too behind your head just for a brief second. Your goalie's trying to track that ball and then the head of the stick, and if you can't see it, then by the time it comes out of your stick, it's too late.
Yeah, absolutely right. Oh, and a second procedure call. So we got one on, two on white and one on gold, we'll call it, as we have the Golden Eagles.
Yeah, Curran Myers on defense on the ball right now. Yellow Jackets just getting him back from a hip surgery, and or hip injury, excuse me, yesterday. So only a second game of the year. He's a big body down there.
Yeah, I'd like to see him D'ing up Eason, or there you go, and moving over to Collins there. That seems like the
smart,
right matchup.
That's a smart matchup right there.
Bull dodge this, buddy. Collins, something that would be interesting to see. I don't know if his stick did end up breaking, but on the last minute possession, he was throwing a pass over to the wing there, and it looked as if he thought maybe his sidewall broke out or something, and that last pass he threw was a little bit more whipped or a little more holding his stick than he would have liked, a little bit off target. Beeson again from that high wing. You know where he's shooting from. That's probably why they moved into attack. That's kind of Beeson Island for right now,
yeah,
I think.
He's feeling it, you know. And again, Barnes initiating from that right side. They're looking to bring that double. George Tech's bringing that double quick. Oh.
The first changeup. First goal low right there by who other than Tyler Collins, the senior midfielder out of El Toro High School, California.
Yeah, his stick was checked right there, which kind of gave that ball just a little bit more pop, and he put that one. That was our first goal that was down low, not off the turf, but in that low corner. You know, Tyler Collins, no stranger to scoring with 15 goals, 37 assists on the regular season.
Who had that assist?
Yeah, that was a good look, too, by Chad McFadden down low to find Collins up top.
And another face-off win for Tech. Their second out of the last three. It's going to be a big deal for them to get moving in the right direction and try to get back to even here with 13:05 left in the second quarter.
Yeah, that's 9 of 13 face-offs for Concordia right now. Oh, great job by Quarles right there. Kind of rocker back behind the crease, just tiptoeing the line there. Oh, stick goes flying. Sam Eck, team's leading scorer, losing his stick. Ball's going back to Concordia. Yang with a good outlet pass.
As we see them carry over and get possession of their half with Young. Great job here, and they're going right back to Collins, who starts to initiate their offense. Appreciate everyone watching at home and tweeting into us. You guys are doing a great job. Happy that you guys are supporting these young men and all of their hard work, these young men and these men and their coaching staffs and players. But let's get back to the action here as we see Georgia Tech initiating in a quick double team there by our man Curran and the Georgia Tech defense. Great job to secure that one.
Just noticed, we have a goalie change. Got Owen Armentrout. He was the starter at the beginning of the year, but unfortunately got a concussion.
So 3-1.
On April the 1st versus Georgia Tech.
Yeah, 4-1. And April Fool's Day, that's what it was.
And Zach Rebellini had come in relief and just did a great job. So
continue to monitor that.
Coaches want to change it up just a little bit. You know, as we mentioned, these shooters were kind of shooting lights out. So
and now we've got Wagnon starting to initiate over the top. He carries underneath to that natural side, which allows him to keep his right hand to the middle of the field. Great swarming pressure there. Yep. That's an amazing
great defensive
stand.
Schneider comes out and really lays the pressure on.
Love that ball pressure, getting the head of the stick into the hands and the chest of the players as we see a great dodge there by Cypher.
Oh, robbed right there by Yang. That was a great move by Seifert to get it down into Wagnon, but Yang up for the challenge and makes an amazing save.
Eagles looking to settle in here, able to clear the ball under the amount of time, and now we've got Beeson back at the midfield.
Yeah, here comes the big three again, right?
That's right. First midfield line back in.
Barnes, Beeson, and Collins.
Collins with the ball over to Barnes. Barnes getting that short stick again. Coach Foss and the staff getting their information into the players. And again, we see that kind of sweeping dodge over the middle. Defensive shift there to slide, rotate, and recover. Beeson, though, with a short stick on this high wing. And a low save there.
Yeah, good one-on-one matchup there. Carrington Kelsey with the defense.
And a great first save of the game. Oh, no angle on that one from Quarles.
I was just about to say the same thing. Not a lot of angle with that left-handed shot over on that right side, but he brings it up high to low and finds that bottom corner.
It's kind of one of those no, 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 yes goals.
After a great pickup, too. I mean, that was a great ground ball to tie the score here at six.
Quarles has been all over the field. Ride, clear, ground balls. He's playing it all. He's doing a great job.
And here we have it. Three procedures and a flag.
So, John, can you explain for the viewers at home what that call is there?
Yeah, so just a few years ago, they implemented if a faceoff man gets three procedural calls against him, then it leads to a 30-second technical penalty. That could be jumping the whistle, that could be not lining up properly, that could be lining in the neutral zone, it could be several different things. And that does go down as a face-off victory for Concordia.
Concordia pushes the ball through X to find Beeson on a step down again. I don't play goalie, but if it were me, I would just hold my hands up in those spots because, I mean, it is going right to the center, bar down every single time.
Yeah, that was another ripping shot. I mean, it's coming in at you at like over 90 plus, right?
Yeah, I don't want to pretend like it's easier or anything like that. I'm never getting the goal. You can pay me enough money to get into a goal.
But again, it's that quick release, you know, and again, McFadden with his second assist in a row and Beeson with his fourth on the night, having a game. Go ahead, son.
I mean, it's impressive. He's got.
And now it's another penalty. This time, this one. How was much, on Skopicki.
How much of an impact have we had here from Poe? I mean, not only is he winning the faceoffs, he's also finding a way to get into the psyche of these players to have to make them move early or to do things that are uncomfortable to them.
Yeah, these guys are trying to do everything they can to get an advantage, including kind of trying to gauge the whistle, right? And unfortunately for Skopicki, he just kind of jumped just a half a second too soon.
Going right back to it. Let's see if they look inside this time. The changeup is on.
Ooh, that was a great ball move. That same play they had last time, but instead of hitting Beeson on that right side, they skipped it and got Collins up top, and he got one more over.
Only a 30-second penalty, so we have 10 seconds left on it. See if they can find another chance. You're hearing Coach Voss yell, touch the corners. You see the white defense is sharing the crease. I love that look.
What a nifty little move right there by Collins. I like that too.
Yeah, that's a nice one for when you're playing in that 3-3. I had a former teammate of mine, shout out to Liam Kelly, a MCLA legend. Used to run that one quite a bit. Very, very Canadian move, if you will.
Yeah, just kind of the fake and then the spin. Just looks cool.
Oh, 100%.
Good
great defense there. Garrett Burns getting pushed off his line. That's hard to do.
Yeah, Hudson Higgins kind of coming very quickly. There we go, another save. That's well needed.
That's the second one there for Armin Trout. The thing I love about Armin Trout is his command and control in the middle of the field. You see him immediately pointing to guys, making sure that guys are in the right spots in the clear, communicating effectively.
Yeah, only a freshman, but definitely plays with poise.
Quick turnover. I didn't even see what was happening. Just watching the sub box there and that the Golden Eagles are going to have possession of the ball yet again after this twice being man up.
Yeah, this defense for Georgia Tech's been out here for a bit. They were able to sub their middies, though. Looks like got Nick Witten in there now, as well as Sam Eck down low.
Shout out to the Quarles family showing out in the Twitter. We got Preston Quarles saying, "No, no, no, yes, goals were the story of my life coaching Pierce Quarles." Huh. Yeah, we've all got one of those, I can guarantee that.
That's great, yeah.
Very humbling as a coach. But for now, isolating on that wing. How did Chad McFadden get a short stick? How did he get so lucky? What a well defensive time check there on the hands to lift that ball up. Gonna make him bring it back.
Yeah.
We were talking yesterday with the officials, and they said that was point of emphasis on the over backs is to get the player back to the midfield line where the ball had kind of been out of line, or I guess had gone over and back necessarily.
Yeah, a lot of times you would see a guy just pick it up and run, and they're blowing the whistle, but that could be 10 yards up above the midline and giving them maybe a little bit of an unfair advantage. So.
Absolutely. As we see Barrow initiating here.
Getting his hands free. Ooh. Barrow winding up like he's going to kind of rip it sidearm and then just does a little overhander
change up.
That was a great play by him.
We're tied back at sevens. 6:32 left in this first half. We've got a doozy of action here, and I don't think we're going to show any signs of slowing down.
Yeah, Barrow out of Peachtree City, Georgia. Let's see if Tech here can not get another penalty, and they get that one off clean, but Concordia coming up with it again. Poe.
Ball's back up top as we see the Golden Eagles initiating offense yet again. We've got Brian Parr in the game, maybe for the first time.
Great hustle by Kelsey right there on Tech to prevent Biso from getting a step.
Oh, here we go. Go back to the well.
Again, Kelsey with some good solid defense. Yeah, if I'm Georgia Tech, you know, I might think about shutting one of these guys off. You know, maybe it's, Beeson or a McFadden and just kind of throw a little wrinkle at them.
Just get them out of their comfort zone at least.
Yeah, or even maybe Barnes, you know, who's been that initiator for, you know, quite a bit once he gets onto the field.
Yeah, you got to think Barnes is sending a really good fruit basket to his boys over there, 2-11 for drawing the poles all year, huh?
Yes.
It's a nice gig for sure.
Oh, look at this pickup here by McFadden. Off to Beeson.
So poised. Roll back.
Oh, off his own guy,
man.
Unfortunately.
I think Andrew Buckley is going to be a little bit upset, but I think he'll live through it. Tough kid.
All right, good defensive stand for Tech. So we're getting the shot clock violation. Ball's going to go the other way.
A huge fan of that drop step take, though, by Beeson there. Carry your guy to the middle where you've gotten a lot. Make him maybe think that you're not, you know, going to carry and move to the top again, even though it's your left hand. Oh. Bispo.
Good effort right there. Oh, look at this.
Come on now.
Oh, he thought about it, right?
Yeah.
Ian Balzer.
Balzer making an impact on both sides of the field today.
Very wise, though, to pull that out. When you've got such the offensive power, you know, go ahead and get your boys back on the field. Let them move it around. Get some ball movement.
Seifert getting started here. Moves the ball over to Wagnon. Wagnon initiating on this high wing. Pushes underneath. And that's just not going to beat Yang.
Not much on that shot. I think he was got his hands caught up just a bit, but that was a good move to get underneath there and then went with that overhand bouncer.
Yeah, I like that move to get underneath to the dominant hand and then continue to run.
Look at Young drawing the double team, but able to successfully get it over to Galbraith.
And Coach Foss and the Golden Eagles want to talk it over with 3:55 left in the second quarter. We're going to cut to a quick commercial break and let the mic breathe, and we'll be right back with you.
out of bounds, either team or personal or technical foul in the middle of the field.
How far out?
The team entitled to the ball.
You do have to be down below. Okay.
Below the string. So in the middle of the field.
Awesome. Welcome back. Still in timeout here. 55 seconds left in the shot clock for the Golden Eagles. Coach Foss over in the huddle getting the grease board out and talking his men through what they want to look through. I'll be interested to see. Georgia Tech is a team that has wrinkled in man and zone both within this game and early in the season. I saw them against Georgia run a little bit of zone. Be interested to see if they go back to that. I'm sure Coach Foss has his guys looking through one or two actions here. But John, for you, what are the keys offensively for the Golden Eagles to have success here late in the second quarter?
Well, they got to continue to get those shots off, you know, and keep ripping them, keep getting them quickly out of their stick. I would look to see probably what we've been seeing here with Barnes probably initiating from one side or the other, rolling back, maybe looking up top to Collins or over to the side to Beeson. If he draws the slide really quickly from the crease there, he might just go through X, get it over to McFadden, and then get it to that backside again, and maybe over to Obispo, who could come from the top.
Yeah, Obispo on offense this time, which I like to see, super athletic. We see a little two-man game behind, and Beeson getting to his left and immediately getting paid. What a great look there. Yeah, a little bit of confusion from the defense.
Yeah, like you said, they just played a little bit of the two-man game. You know, Barnes went back there with him, and Beeson drives that left side. Just enough of a pick and just enough to little confusion between the Tech defenders of who was going to stay with him. And he just got a one or two steps over GLE and let that one rip, and that was a great finish for his fifth goal. Go on, young man. Have a game.
Yeah, I'm throwing the kitchen sink at that guy if he catches the ball again, man.
And Poe just wins that one cleanly to himself. He's putting on a clinic right now.
Yeah, I'm excited to see, although that one is scored inside, I'll be interested to see if Concordia can get Andrew Buckley going. You know, he was a presence inside last night and was able to make a significant impact on the game. You know, all these shooters coming from the outside, it'll be interesting to see if they can, you know, work on that body shot as well as the headshot. You know, the headshots being the range shots, then looking inside as well. So, for now.
Crosby with a great ground ball there to keep that play alive and found McFadden inside. But Armantrout able to make a really good save.
Armantrout's the real deal. Got a ball scrum in the middle.
Possession timeout here by Coach Lovick and the Yellow Jackets.
Coach Foss is fired up.
Coach Foss is fired up. I like him. You know, he's always coaching. He's just built a great program down there in Irvine, California with Concordia Eagles. As we mentioned yesterday's broadcast, this is going to be the last tournament for MCLA tournament for Concordia as they're going to move into the NCAA ranks starting next season.
They'll join a pretty prestigious group. You've seen some other programs jump from the MCLA rank to the NCAA. The D1 level, you've seen Michigan and Utah both experiencing success in reaching the national tournament this year. You've also seen it at different levels, whether it's Linwood, D2 to D1. I'm thinking more so Westminster, programs like that have gone from the MCLA to the NCAA transition.
Yeah, I was going to mention Westminster, a former member of my conference, the Rocky Mount Lacrosse Conference. Mason Goodhand, a longtime advocate for lacrosse in the state of Utah.
Yep. He's still coaching there?
Coaching that program. No, He is not.
I was going to say that would be like one of the longest careers I've ever heard of. He recruited me when I was in high school. That dates me quite a bit.
But we did talk about possibly getting a Westminster club team in next season, perhaps.
Oh, really?
There's been some talk.
Wonder what Mike Brand thinks about that. And I digress. Great job so far here from both teams, but excited to see this matchup right here.
Wow, what a play by Quarles. The speed. He is fast.
Yeah.
And to get those hands free on the run. And a frozen rope right over Yang's shoulder.
Yeah, Parker Quarles telling me that he probably thinks it's due to him playing U-17 ball at U-14, but I think he's just got that dog in him.
I believe it, you know. Wow. Super impressive there.
If I am the Eagles, I am making sure that I force all of the lefties underneath from now on.
Yeah, that's
hard task to do. I mean, it's not like it's easy.
That's Pierce's third of the game. And another face-off win by Poe.
Oh. But unfortunately, not able to connect on the pass there. The ball's going to be taken up. Yellow Jackets get it over the middle. Ball comes into the offensive zone. It's going to be Seifert. Matthias with the ball now. We saw him coming in and out of the game late yesterday versus Texas.
Here comes Krasicki into the game, number 42. Looks like his first action. He's that spark on the team. Senior, as we mentioned, Scott, his PhD.
I was wondering if I remember that. Rocket propulsion, was it?
Yeah, he's been working with NASA.
Got his doctorate. I think that was, what, recently, like the last couple days, right?
A couple weeks ago. Yeah. They had a ceremony last weekend, I believe. He had two goals yesterday and definitely energized this Yellow Jacket team.
And again, you see him going to that sweep over the top, pass across, and then they're trying to flex this, the nature of the support on these wings here. So right there, you see if they support, they do not help off that short stick. And then again here, they'll see if they support here. They do a little bit, and a good job fading there by Matthias, and an even better shot. Devin Rowan doing a great job. Only got 5 seconds left in the shot clock, so Georgia Tech deciding to put their big man, Curran Myers, at the middle of field to be defensive-minded in transition here.
And another great play by Young, the defensive midfielder right there. Timed that slide perfectly, knocks down the pass.
Young is the real deal.
Yeah, shot clock runs out, and we're going to go the other way here with Concordia.
I'm glad one of us knew what was going on. 107 left, tied 8-8 in the second quarter. That means that this possession,
collapsing them,
should they get it, will be the last one, if they wish, of the half. But I don't know if they wish it. The players might not have, but it looks like Coach Foss is definitely trying to get that last shot. Of the quarter.
Great timeout there.
Yeah.
Barnes was coming in. He wanted one. And
right
checked
into the teeth.
Right at the last second. But Coach Foss able to get the TO and set something up here with 51 seconds left.
Robert Romero, been interacting quite a bit both yesterday and today. He said keeping the shorty on Beeson is an interesting choice. I would agree. I don't know if they're going to, you know, lock or slide early to that. But I would definitely say that that's, you're doing that at your own peril if you're putting a short stick on that guy.
Yeah, absolutely. He's having a day. I mean, he's just shooting lights out right now. I would probably do what you mentioned, maybe just shut him off, throw a little wrinkle. But these guys have so many weapons, you know, it's just you pick your poison.
That's right.
You know, shut one off. I mean, then you're just going to be asking for trouble from the rest of the usual suspects.
Yeah, Buckley, Collins. I mean, these guys are all legit. And that's what I think will be interesting coming out of this timeout here is the last time we had a timeout, we saw – from the Golden Eagles, that is. We saw them go to a little on-ball pick on this near side wing and then an exchange on the backside to get a shooter open. I can't remember what shooter specifically it was, but we have our ones hopping back out on the field. Same way they came out of the last time out with Obispo being that third midfielder along with Collins.
Well, after that last time out, you know, they got the ball to X and played a little two-man game
with
Obispo, and who just came around that left. This time they got Barnes out on this upper wing here. Maybe they're looking to have him dodge that alley.
This looks like a zone. Hard to tell, though, with the offensive shape.
Oh.
Some energy coming from the GT bench trying to get it loud as we see this big little pick for Beeson again. Pick not as successful there, an extremely physical defense there. I love that physicality at the GLE.
Yeah, by Higgins bringing the lumber.
Johns Creek, Georgia native. Obispo with a nice shot on the run to get the ball back to X. Let's see if they go back to that big little pick. The other thing that this big little pick will do, uh-oh, that's a big, big pick. I don't want that. They've got Collins' number today, sending almost two poles to him. The interesting thing about this pick, if they go back to it right now, which looks like they are, is watch for what's going to happen as they try to support this off of Chad McFadden. If they do get a successful pick here, they're going the opposite direction. So watch what happens.
Bispo's feet weren't set, so he was moving. Even though he got the worst end of that, they're calling a legal screen just because he was still moving.
Extremely tough. That's how it goes. Refs are calling this one consistently. Coach Foss trying to find out exactly what the communication or the style of that would be. But for now, I think what a great game. Tied up at 8-8. I mean, especially considering the face-off difference, it's remarkable the game's this close. Credit to all the players in the field continuing to compete and making this thing, I mean, just such an energizing game. I'm having a lot of fun watching. I'm sure everybody at home is too. John, you got anything before we head into the halftime here?
No, you said this is amazing. 8-8. It doesn't get much better than this. You mentioned the face-offs. 8-1 advantage in that second quarter going to Concordia. And so to have it tied up with that many more possessions that they're getting is a testament to the defense of the Yellow Jackets. So I know Georgia Tech yesterday against Texas came out in that third quarter and exploded for 10 goals. They also gave up 6 goals that quarter, too. So it'll be interesting to see where we are on that.
Definitely excited. Hope you guys are continuing to follow along at home, and we're excited to continue to feature your tweets and follow along with this game with you as we kick this over to halftime for a short break.
QX2 Minimus Carbon Shaft generates a quick release and is fit with signature slide grip.
Sounds fancy.
The new Evo QX glove features cloud cuff and hybrid taper fit for maximum mobility and speed.
Does that mean harder checks?
Yes, it does.
Every player knows the skills you learn on the field can be the foundation for anything you choose to do in life.
Thank you for connecting me to a greater community.
We're growing beyond goals on the field.
And our futures are united.
So thank you, Lacrosse.
For inspiring me to be me.
We are better,
safer,
and wiser together.
And we're building a stronger future
for everyone.
Introducing the new Warrior Evo QX2 head with Thermalock Plus resin, providing more consistency in all weather conditions.
All I know is this thing rips.
The new Evo QX glove features cloud cuff and hybrid taper fit for maximum mobility and speed.
Does that mean harder checks?
Yes, it does. The Evo QX2 Minimus Carbon Shaft generates a quick release and is fit with signature slide grip.
Sounds fancy.
Built for accuracy, built for consistency, built to win. Just play the game.
Cut! Wrong line, Rob. It's just play the game. Run it again.
Just play the game. Introducing the new Warrior Evo QX2 head with Thermalock Plus resin, providing more consistency in all weather conditions.
All I know is this thing rips.
It's on us to stop sexual assault.
To get in the way before it happens.
To get a friend home safe.
And to not blame the victim.
It's on us.
To look out for each other.
To not look the other way.
It's on us to stand up.
To step in.
To take responsibility.
It's on us, all of us,
to stop sexual assault.
Learn how and take the pledge at itsonus.org.
Me, I promise I'm too much. Ay, I can never let up, even if you had enough. Ay, this ain't for the faint of heart. We always playing rough. I had enough. It ain't love.
QX2 Minimus Carbon Shaft generates a quick release and is fit with signature slide grip.
Sounds fancy.
The new Evo QX glove features cloud cuff and hybrid taper fit for maximum mobility and speed.
Does that mean harder checks?
Yes, it does.
Every player knows. The skills you learn on the field can be the foundation for anything you choose to do in life.
Thank you for connecting me to a greater community.
We're growing beyond goals on the field.
And our futures are united.
So thank you, Lacrosse.
For inspiring me to be me.
We are better,
safer,
and wiser together.
And we're building a stronger future
for everyone.
Welcome back. Here we are in beautiful Round Rock, Texas. This is John Robinette, joined with Patrick Franklin. Coming out of halftime, we've got a score of 8-8. We've had a doozy of a game so far. Huge performance by number two, Nick Beeson for Concordia. 5 goals on the game. And on the other side for Georgia Tech, number 27, Devin Ron having a game. Looks like we're going to be starting with Georgia Tech ball. I'm not quite sure why, but anyway, here we are. As Tech works that ball behind to Quarles, moving it up top to Witten. Back over to Barrow, shakes and bakes, gets across the top to Ron. Barreling in and a quick shot, saved by Yang. Ground ball picked up by
Lucci. Look at this effort from the ride. Georgia Tech's been dropping in for the most part and now going to that two pressure down. Good job by the Golden Eagles to evade that pressure.
Why was there no face-off?
Because they caught conduct foul on the assistant coach of this team during
halftime. All right, just got word. There was a dead ball conduct foul at the end of that first half against Concordia assistant coach. So that's why Georgia Tech was awarded that ball. But no harm done on that. Now possession back to Concordia. Over to the left side with Biso and moves it back up top to Barnes.
Collins bearing down in this pipe. Sees Barnes to Beeson. Extremely aggressive approach and Beeson cannot miss.
Wow, he spins to his left and a bounce shot right along that post to beat Armantrout. What a great play, even the slide came super fast and aggressive, but Beeson with the presence to go ahead and roll away from that pressure, get his hands free, and again, Patrick, that huge and quick release.
I'm a super big fan of Nick Beeson. Our shot clocks are back. Let's go. Shout out to the op staff here getting it going.
Battle with Pizak. And Poe.
Don't let those like knees touch the ground.
Looks like the ball is kind of tied up. And Poe gets it out and gets it up.
Poe is going down. I mean, it's actually hard to say that with Beeson doing so well, but one of those two has to be the MVP of this game.
And look at Abispo. Team Georgia Tech electing not to really slide out to him and letting him go ahead and rip that, but kind of just missed his target.
Sure, Obispo will take a mental note of that the next time that he's stepping in for a shot.
Yeah, here comes Garrett Burns, number 8, into the lineup. We didn't see a lot of him last night in that game.
Came in a little bit more late in relief. Yeah, he's big body, and like we said earlier, that those levers of his are so long. I wonder how that would affect the force that he can create. So that's a nice pick there, and again, this little weave sweep action. But Georgia Tech has made an adjustment so far. That's the second time that we've seen Hudson Higgins rotating up off the base. So it'll be interesting to see how well Mazaki and I think on the other side it'll be either McFadden or Buckley on that low pinch spot. We'll see how that comes into play. If they're supporting from those low spots, I'd love to see them pass it one more and have that guy turn the corner like we saw Andrew Buckley score on the game winner last night.
Quarles with a quick feed over to the long pole. Ian Balzer gets a shot off, but Yang up for it. Georgia Tech remains with possession.
We're on the clocks. We're ready to go.
If I'm being prophetic about anything, I'm going to guess that he gets a goal by the end of this game if he keeps shooting. It's a great take. Love to see pole goals. But for now, Georgia Tech setting up. Open set for right now. Ball in the stick going underneath with Quarles. Quarles and Ron have switched, kind of playing X and at the lefty wing here. Good look inside. And a great save by Yang, being poised and be able to see that one and pick it up from such a short angle.
Joseph Rose with a quick shot. Yang with the save. Getting it up to Young again, who's looking to clear. Again, relentless, as you mentioned, on that ride, getting swarmed, but up for the challenge are the Eagles, getting it back on their offensive end, over to Burns. Now to Barnes.
And now we're back. That first midfield line. But Brian Parr is going to take the spot of Collins here.
How can Beeson be that wide open up at the top after he's just been shooting lights out?
Still got a short stick.
Draws the quick slide right there.
And here's where moving it through X is going to help, because they're supporting from those low spots, whether it's Higgins or...
Oh! Rings the post. He almost had his sixth.
Uh-oh. Who's at X?
Excuse me, he almost had his seventh.
Death taxes and lefty shooting inside pipe. I love that take there by Quarles.
Yeah, that was a beautiful kind of just stop, turn of dime, twist, and the lefty a little bit, again, low to high. That's his fourth of the game. Gets the scoring going for Georgia Tech to knot this one up again.
Tanner G, I got to agree with you. Nick Beeson having himself a day.
Well, yeah, I'm just surprised that Georgia Tech's given him so much room right there. I mean, twice he got the ball up top and had hands free ready to shoot.
Yeah, when you've got two-thirds of your team's goals, probably going to need to identify that guy.
And here we had the first procedure call on Pizak. So that's one. As you know, last half, they got down in that situation and had two man-up advantages because of face-off violations. So.
And in a game like this where the margin for error is razor thin, those kind of plays can mean getting another couple of days to spend time with your family, with your boys here in Round Rock, Texas at the MCLA National Tournament, punching their ticket to the Thursday quarterfinal round.
And despite that lopsided stat in the faceoff, I mean, it's a tie game. It's a good look there by Obispo. Got the backup. I like the overhand shot.
Good job dodging through contact there. Sees the backside of the defense, but unfortunately just a little bit too high. Trying to get the ball out there to McFadden.
Carrington Kelsey again playing some really good individual defense. Solid effort by him.
We've seen Kelsey out quite a bit. I think almost every possession or every other possession, he's out there. Stoppage of play, getting the shot clock down to 76 seconds so we can effectively have the game played. Flowing well so far, and a great clear out there by Nick Witten using his speed to get the ball on the offensive side to Barrow, who's immediately swarmed by a pack of Eagles. What's a group of Eagles called? Do you know?
I do not.
Someone on Twitter, help me out with that one. Tell me what a group of Eagles is called. I know they're actually more solitary creatures, but...
A flock.
Flock of Eagles? Got them.
Great band in the 80s.
Got to be the Hair Cotton. But a great move by Nick Witten to get underneath there. And swarming defensive pressure by the Golden Eagles, showing those talons. Great job by Schneider.
Yeah, Slumsky with a great pickup right there for Concordia. As the ball goes back to offense for the Golden Eagles. Young keeping it alive.
So much ball pressure there.
And we're going to get a loose ball hold call. Possession back to Georgia Tech.
Refs are letting the boys play today.
Yeah, Young a little shaken up, but he's coming off on his own. Looks okay.
And are my eyes cheating me, or is there a short stick on Nick Beeson right now?
Yeah, that'd be number one, Nick Witten out of Windmere, Florida. The senior midfielder.
Love to see how the game is growing in the state of Florida. Really impressive between whether it's NCAA ball that's helping it out and definitely some great coaching going on down there.
Oh, there's Collins with the move that he had last night for the first two goals of the game. Just kind of that using that big frame and bulldodging in there a bit. Hits the post. That's the second post here in the last two possessions.
I love the energy of both of these teams' attackmen riding the ball back. They're just telling you, hey, look, that's my ball. You just temporarily have my ball. I want it back. As Obispo tries to fire, not able to get past Armin Trout, not even on cage. McFadden picking up the ball at X here.
Yeah, that was Higgins again sliding very quickly. They start with the short pull there on Beeson in Witten, but then Higgins super fast to slide, which has given Obispo some looks at cage.
Beeson, where he wants to be with a short stick. Let's see if they start this action here and sweep over the top so they can get him this one-on-one right.
And Obispo, there it was.
Yeah, they went back to it the opposite direction. That's what they've been doing all day, and it puts a lot of strain on the defense to have to support your crease guy is a lot lower who you're usually sliding off of, and so it puts a ton of strain on those wing defenders to think, should I help out? Nah, I really just can't right now because, you know, you don't really have any Jason support off Nick Beeson or else you're going to get G'd up. Yeah, that's a great job by Obispo to get his first of the day.
First of the day, yes. First point. That was his third shot kind of in a row there, and we said if he just stays with it, it's going to be coming down. That was a great overhand shot too. And Poe wins it to himself once again. Relentless pressure right there by Curran Myers. Oh, they're shutting off all of his outlets. Really making Poe work for this one. Finally, we get McFadden coming up to help to get Poe off the field.
Thank you to Chris Freer and Ted Bedwell following along with us. A group of Eagles is typically called a convocation, but it can also be called a soar, an airy, or even a spread.
Oh, good to know.
That's just riveting stuff. You're coming in and you're being our third on-field reporter next year if you want to come. We'll accept that.
I still think I like Flock of Eagles.
Flock of Eagles, still number one in our hearts. Great action initiated. They go underneath instead of over the top this time.
Oh! That was a good pass right there. Kind of put Grant right in that shooting position, but Tech quick to slide and Burns kind of just drug his stick just a bit.
Yeah, great windup there by Burns. They had a swarming pressure there, though, by the Yellow Jackets to get the ball out and into their offensive possession. I'd like to see Barrow initiate here. He was electric yesterday and a big-time party starter for them in terms of drawing slides. And right here, yes. Like the changeup from Corals. Shot it near side, top right last time. Now changing it to go bottom left. Good job using the screen as well.
Yeah, it's Slumsky, 18, number 18, coming out at him and kind of shot it right off of his right hip, kind of using that as a little bit of a screen, making it difficult for Yang to see the ball.
You got to do anything you can to get some advantages on these goalies, especially Yang. I mean, he's been lights out.
Yeah, if he's seeing it, I mean, good percentage he's going to save it. Mm. You know, Yang coming in with a 56.5% save percentage on the year.
Barrow a little bit wide there. Lefty alley dodge and shoots it sidearm. Angle not so great, but allows the offense to get initiated with 15 seconds left here at X. See Corals with a wraparound shot, not able to get it on cage, and that'll be a change of possession for anyone following along at home. Lacrosse, very unique rule in the sport of lacrosse is that anytime there is a shot, the closest player to where the ball went out of bounds will be awarded possession of that ball. So somewhat of a hustle play, if you will, but only on shots, not necessarily on passes.
Yeah, 43, Braden Schneider. good hustle to get possession for the Eagles. They clear that one fairly easily and get their offensive set going again. Here with Collins and Barnes. And coming in, checking in right now also is Brett Masaki.
He's been playing at X attack for a while, so it's interesting they're now running him from the midfield, and he's got Barrow on him and immediately working to X. So see if they go invert here. Although they've got shorts on both of their attackmen right now. Immediately go to the inverted X. See if they support off Beeson. They don't, smartly so. Swing it over the top. What a skip look.
Kidding me.
I'm going to need to start getting more hands in the counting figure here. Is that six or is that five?
I think it's seven. That's seven for him, and that's that same play. Barnes alley dodging and then looking across with a skip pass up top to Beeson, who's just got time and room. And shooting lights out.
I am sending that kid a men's league application for the second that he gets done with his graduate school here. See if we can get him out to Dallas, Texas to play for the Flyers.
Oh, here we go again. Poe with the quick faceoff. Good job right there by Pizak to shut off the break.
Hey, Bees. Seven? Seven. Coming back for more, though.
Yeah, when you're this hot, you want to stay on the field and keep it rolling.
Interesting adjustment here by the Eagles. They're deciding to keep on their LSM and as well as the face-off player from Georgia Tech. Extremely physical there off the ground ball as we see McFadden go and collect it.
Yeah, Armin Trout with a huge save right there off of last night's hero, Andrew Buckley, who had the game winner with, you know, seconds left against Northeastern.
That was an interesting little 1-3-1 look. Going back to that, they had 5-on-5 because they were deciding to keep both of their specialists on, whether it was the LSM or the faceoff specialist, and play in a 1-3-1 formation that allowed them a lot more space. Interesting to see if they go back to that. It's fun to see Coach Foss and his staff adding some wrinkles like that. You can tell they're comfortable even though it's just a two-goal game.
Yeah, working out of this 1-4-1. Nice wide set. Bispo looking to get his hands free. Back to Beeson.
Great support defense from the Yellow Jackets there. And a transition opportunity this time for Carrington.
Yeah, I think it was the first shot of the game for Beeson where he actually bounced it. He's just been ripping high with a lot of success.
I think the only other one that he might have bounced when he hit that roll back right to left. And it was a little bit of a chopper with his left hand. Yeah, absolutely changing it up, which, you know, if you're a goalie, it's kind of that game within the game. You've saved a guy, you've scored a guy high, maybe put it down by his legs. We saw Collins doing that early. Oh, great look there. That's Wagnon inside.
Great collapsing on the defense there with Schneider.
And that's been the difference, I think, in this game defensively for what Georgia Tech has seen from Concordia that they did not see from Texas is that defensive support and sliding. And oh, that one hurts. What a good soak. That one's going to hurt for Quarles. That's going to get him easy action on windups here on out throughout the game. He's going to be able to get his hitch and his face dodge going. What a great soak there, though.
Schneider. Soaking that one up, number 43.
You know Yang's going to give him a fruit basket for that one, man. That's selling out for your goalie. I'll be interested to see if they make him come off the field here, though.
I thought he would have to.
Yeah. And
yeah, they're calling for him out.
Was possession of the – I was under the impression that possession of the ball is with the Eagles.
Yeah, coaching staff for Concordia saying the same thing you are, Patrick. They thought that should be their ball, but
it was bang bang play. I guess they just didn't get up to the ball quick enough, or maybe it's an AP situation. I'm not going to speculate too much, but I'm sure that the Golden Eagles will be gritty enough to lock it in here for the last 30 seconds of this possession. Uh-oh, here it is. And see, that's exactly what's going on the other side of the field. Both these teams go into that action over the top where it's kind of a three-man, and they're getting adjacent support and then just passing into the teeth of the defense there. Uh-oh, where have I seen this before? Oh, robbery. Absolute robbery from Armin Trout.
That's got to be good. That's got to feel good for him.
And after a flurry of shots there at the end, it's going to be an 11-9 score for you. The Golden Eagles leading by two going into the fourth quarter. A little bit confusing at home if you're looking at this. You know, you got your home is 11, guest is 9. Usually in lacrosse, you see the white team is wearing, there is the home team rather. Not the case today on either of our broadcasts. I just want to give that piece to you so you're not getting a little bit confused. John, what are you seeing here so far that's kind of popping out at you that you think might be a big key for either of these teams, you know, to close this one out or to take it back if you're Tech?
Well, right now, like I said, we've got Beeson on Concordia just having a game 7 points, or excuse me, 7 goals. And for Georgia Tech, you know, we've got Quarles with 4. Those two guys are kind of showing a lot of great individual action here. If I'm Tech right now, I'm looking to, you know, probably shut off number 2 and like have somebody else kind of beat me for this game. Even though the faceoff has been so lopsided, you know, Tech's still only down by 2. And as you know, they can score in bunches quickly.
Have Tech had a man up yet this game?
Don't believe so.
I'm trying to think back. I know that, I mean, we know that Concordia has had 2, 3, maybe even 4 at this point, but that's something that I think would be a big game changer if they could get maybe a, you know, possession based off a penalty or something like that. No, I know they did get the possession to start the half after that conduct foul, but
it's been a pretty clean game. I really think the only couple penalties I can recall were the violations at the X. Mm-hmm. And they've had 2, and they were able to capitalize on 1 of them.
Yeah, officials are doing a great job so far.
Yeah, good, clean game. Both teams playing hard, playing fair.
I think for me, this game comes down to composure. There's so many games, especially in these games, where you've got kids that you love and care about, you know, and teammates that you love and care about. We're all here energized and, you know, we've put in a lot of work to get here. It's important to take a step back and take a deep breath every once in a while to remember that, you know, getting revved up and seeing red is not necessarily the best tactic for making good decisions and doing the right things in critical moments of the game. So for me, I'm telling all my guys, take a deep breath. Let's do the things that have gotten us here and have led our program to success. Both these programs, you know, perennial invitees to this tournament. So they know what they got here with, and I'd love to see them both just settle in and really make an impact on the rest of this game.
Yeah, I don't really see Georgia Tech panicking right now, down by 2. Like you said, they've had lots of success through the years and this season. Coach said they focus on what they do. Right? They don't really let other teams kind of dictate what they need to do. So they're going to stay confident, keep moving the ball on offense. Close shot right there by Collins, just missed his mark.
Georgia Tech, at least temporarily, going back to that double pull in the midfield as they've got pulls on both high scores at the midfield between Collins and Beeson. But that allows for a short stick right there.
Another post right off the top by Beesbo. Collins with a good ground ball to keep it down here on the offensive end for the Eagles.
Great job there by him to keep that possession. And as you see, so we've got 2 defenders playing up in the midfield to take away those threats. That means that Brett Mazzocchi is going to have a short stick. Let's see if he looks to go at that, just like we see up over the top on the high wing here by Barnes. Rex to McFadden, back up top. Brett splits, sees a rollback, back to McFadden. Zaki sets a pick down, finds Beeson. Oh, and through flow of play, we've now got Collins with a short stick, and I've seen this movie before. And you can see the Georgia Tech defense starting to identify, getting to those early doubles and being extremely physical with Beeson, trying to do anything to knock him off his game.
Yeah, Higgins and Lewis both kind of collapsing on him right there, forcing that shot that just kind of went down in the turf. Really not a threat on that one.
Oh, and drawing a crowd, Mizaki, with that little small little rollback hesitation. Unfortunately, it's the second kind of over the top of the defense pass we've seen not be completed.
And Mizaki would like that one back. That was a tough pass to make. That was all the way across, you know, right across the heart of the defense.
Both teams exerting an extreme amount of energy and effort here. Both these teams played last night. Concordia, I mean, quick turnaround, two games in 24 hours. And Georgia Tech playing that earlier game around 5 o'clock yesterday against Texas in the close to what was peak heat and all the day. So you know fatigue is going to start to settle in here. Both teams have big benches and have played a lot of games this year. Another great double team. Oh, and another soak. That's the second soak today. Let's go.
By 43, yeah, even Schneider, the same player that had to go out from taking the shot last time. But, yeah, you mentioned the games last night.
And, yeah.
Of course, Concordia had that thriller with just seconds left, and Northeastern took them all the way down the wire, whereas Georgia Tech was able to kind of really rest some of their starters. So we'll see how that plays out this last quarter, which team is going to be fresher. I feel like Georgia Tech's had more depth at many of these positions, although this game they've been playing pretty much their ones the entire time.
Shout out to Jackson Leinert following along. He said, from one Bryant to CUI, number two to another, shout out Beeson. Have a day, kid. Obispo. Oh, and a great face dodge.
Oh, wow, that was almost a highlight reel goal there by Buckley. Great ball movement. Really impressed with this Concordia team, how quickly they get this ball in and out of their stick.
Yeah, I loved that dodge there from Burns, not settling for the shot with low angle, moving it through X, and then looking inside after drawing the rotation. Bispo with a nice fake. I don't think the goalie got a piece of it.
I don't think so. Kind of bad angle on that one for that right-handed shot.
7 seconds left in the shot clock. Obispo going with that wraparound and not able to secure that one.
Yeah, good defensive stand by Georgia Tech.
We have yet to see one of those backhand goals go in and be ecstatic when it does happen this weekend. Georgia Tech, having their clear change up a little bit because Irvine doing a great job taking away that nearside guy, but Armantrout up to the task. Field general out there getting the ball stretched from corner to corner to get possession for his team as he finds Barrow, who moves it through X.
Yeah, that's just a sign of a real smart team, very well coached, being able to kind of sense what the other team's doing on that ride and change it up a bit.
Oh, great patience by Barrow, but unfortunately only finds the outside of the cage here. Shout out to Prodigy Productions for having the ambient mic on the sideline, getting to hear a little bit, almost like we were mic'd up back there on the end line. You know, we got that mic back there and the players are communicating, trying to plead their case, but officials saw it very clearly and made the right call. So we go the other way.
Yeah, not the greatest offensive possession there for Georgia Tech.
Uh-oh.
No look and a save.
What
by
a freaking play by Armantrout. That was really impressive. The feed, that, you know, I think a lot of people probably see Collins and say, oh, this guy's a killer shooter. And he is, right? But his feeding ability is what's really made him different this year. I mean, he has, looking back over his stats, 15 goals, but 15 goals, 37 assists.
Yeah.
Yeah. Almost thought that was his ground ball stat for a second there, but what silky mitts to be able to sling that thing into Buckley and Buckley to handle it, and Armantrout collapsing it again. I wonder if they'll make an adjustment to start shooting high on him as well.
Yeah, that was sweet. That was his second kind of no-look pass. You know, he looks off, which is just a great veteran move. And But you mentioned Armentrout up for the task. What a beautiful save. Timeout by Concordia. Or excuse me, Georgia Tech.
Georgia Tech starting to realize only 9 minutes left, still plenty of time in this game, but certainly not anything to be, you know, dawdling around or being cavalier about play. Definitely trying to make sure that they get all their guys in the right spots and have all the right ammunition available to them in order to find a successful operation here. If it's me, I would love to see, you know, Barrow's been a little bit quiet here. He's a great player. I'd like to see something going on with him, or I would love to see a two-man game of some sort, whether it's with Quarles or with Ron on that lefty wing. Maybe set a pick to the underneath side and refuse that pick going topside. And there's some real good opportunities here as you've got shooters all over the field for the Georgia Tech Yellow Jackets.
Yeah, Yellow Jackets, not in super familiar territory. A lot of their wins have been kind of one-sided. I mean, they did have a two-goal loss back on April the 2nd versus Northeastern. Three-goal loss to Liberty. Yang with a huge save.
Huge save.
Sam Eck with the shot. It was a good little play they drew up, getting Sam free from about 10 yards out.
Eck's been quiet today, too. Overpass, controlled. One more up to Collins. Collins up to task in the all-meat castle matchup of the week between him and our boy Curran. Curran Myers.
Yeah, that was just kind of a clinical clear right there. That was a great job of busting that ride, getting the ball down to the right side, moving it through X. Now here we go. Barnes probably going to initiate with an alley dodge, maybe. Oh, chooses to come across.
And that's the first time. That's the first time we've seen him go backwards with that ball with a little spill pass or a pull pass, as they call it. It's a way to keep them multiple in their attack points. You're hearing 100 from the sideline, which usually means we want to get that ball around one time. I don't know why they don't just call it 1, 2, or 3. But 100, 200, 300 is usually the call there as they get set up back into that motion-based offense that they want to. Last time they went over the top. Good windup and hitch there. Selling shot using fakes that are available to him before getting into an invert set. Let's see if they draw early rotation here to support the short stick at X.
Oh. Silky move by Barnes.
That was so impressive.
Wow.
I mean, I wonder if that guy played football. That looked like a little, you know, stutter step, put the foot in the ground up the sideline and get into the middle. That was amazing.
Yeah, he got Sam Eck kind of going, leaning just a little bit too much the other way, and just an explosive move just to get right across, and a great finish. And, again, up high.
Yeah.
There we go. Congratulated on the sideline. Barnes coming out. That's his second of the day to go along with one assist. Pizak comes up with the faceoff win and the GB, and he's going to go for it. Oh, man, that one almost snuck in there. Pizak, you know, he's got the green light. He scored twice yesterday, so coach isn't going to be upset about that. That one almost squeaked in past Yang.
That was a great take. Got to be able to – oh.
Grant rolls it back into him, but
huge run
great
ball.
Pickup right there by Brian Parr. Haven't called his name much tonight, but that is a huge play to keep possession here for the Golden Eagles, up by three.
Yeah, so we got Parr, Burns, and Beeson in at the midfield. Looks like Beeson will draw the long stick. Ball's moved to X.
We got Parr down, so no goals or and one assist on this season. So don't know if he was mainly a defensive role, but takes the shot and gets it. First goal of the year, is that correct?
I think he might have had, did he have one last night? No?
no, and that gets the Concordia bench fired up. Some guys holding their hands up in like disbelief, like, you scored. Yeah, look at coach coming out, everybody.
That's how you know it's the first one.
You'd love to see that.
And yeah.
Poe with another ground ball and a face-off win.
You know, I saw some rumblings on Twitter whenever I was getting ready for the tournament. Oh, what a great play by Devin Ron. Do you think the captain wants to stop playing?
Oh, you know these guys. They're on a mission. They are not going to quit until the final whistle of this game. That was just an unfortunate turnover right there leading to that quick goal. But that is all the momentum you needed. Right before that, the Eagle bench fired up, you know, with Brian Parr getting that goal. You could hear a pin drop over on Georgia Tech sideline. And now Ron able to ignite a little spark down there for the bench.
It's good to see that life.
Oh, good play by the D. Balzer, but unfortunately, ball pops right into Young's stick, who, again, a force on GB's on the face-off wing. Pizak visibly upset and mad over there about that last one.
It's a highly emotional game, playing for keeps here, as some teams will get to continue to play and some teams will be going home, and you know, their teams will be no longer the same. Even if they're returning players, no one team 1 year is the same, and I think it's important to always, you know, be present in the moment, and sometimes I can get a little bit too present when you get focused on magnified things, but I'm sure he'll get right back into the game and start inserting himself into this one.
Leaving Young out there on the offensive end. We haven't seen a whole lot of that.
Yeah, they've done that a couple of times with Young and Obispo. Late in the shot clock, so maybe they're just trying to keep him on by the nature of, you know, the time of possession. Oh,
Collins
squirts that one off the back foot.
Sneaks that one in by Armentrout. See some looks of disbelief on the coaching staff for Georgia Tech right now.
Cordia definitely handling their business at this point in the game.
Yeah, I mean,
certainly not over. 4:41 left, but it's certainly starting to get a little bit more real.
Yeah, you're gonna see Georgia Tech probably pressing out a little more, especially if Concordia gets this next possession. Who do we got for Georgia Tech in here on this face? Oh, it's Pizak again. Oh, and another GB, another great play by the wing, and what a great check. Wow, the textbook over the head check by Balzer. That was surgical.
We like.
And much needed, right?
We like. Great play.
So here we go. And look at the pressure that Concordia is doing.
I don't know why.
Pressing
they've got
way
multiple
out.
Multiple guys over the end line.
And Yang following that stick, going down low, making that save.
You see, Yang was already kind of down there. He looked like you know. Come on down in here, buddy.
Yeah, he was following that stick head.
As most goalies are taught to match the head of the stick of the shooter, as we see Eck getting over the middle here and a great soak there. Can't see what number that was by Concordia. Maybe might have been Jack Tanner there with the soak.
Yeah, Eck, the goal leader for this team on the season. Yeah, held off this sheet today.
Oh, good look by Barrow inside, but unfortunately not able to connect. Quarles.
Look at that athleticism of Yang coming out of the cage, getting that ground ball, getting that pass all the way back across the field, setting up the clear.
It's got to be the leg sleeve. Wait,
10-man ride going on. Armentrout comes out, gets that ball. And Longpole over to Ron. Oh.
Wanted that.
You know he'd like to have that one back.
Yeah.
He had a great opportunity right there. Nice pass over from Balzer. Balzer's having himself a game.
Yeah, Balzer with that over the head check and then getting an opportunity to transition there for his team. Like I said, I think he's going to have at least one more of those to make a swing at this four-goal lead.
Yeah, Tech needs to kind of rip them. Oh, Behalzer. I mean, excuse me, Yang with the great save.
Yeah, Yang on Wagnon right there. I think it was kind of just a little bit center mass. A great job to try to ride it back here.
Schneider gets the ball back for himself.
Schneider just taking all of the abuse. Two block shots today, multiple soak checks. Coral's going to go early here. Finds Ron in transition. Ron gets the middle, just a bit outside.
You can see right now Tech is pressing just a bit. They're starting
great
to sense
timeout.
It. 2.5 minutes to go, down by four.
Coach Foster took a timeout.
Yeah, that's smart. You know, settle your defense down just a bit. There's really no time to hesitate for Georgia Tech. They need to go at it. They need four within 2 minutes, 38 seconds.
Yeah, they're going to need some penalty help or some amazing work on the wing play at these faceoffs because, you know, to get – if you were asking me, you know, yesterday, well, even yesterday they had a little bit of a struggle with faceoff exit times with how good Texas was at securing that clamp. But, you know, you're going to need some penalty help or something, you know, just to get that ball rolling in the right direction. We know they've got the firepower for it and – have the defense to stop it, but as we saw from Concordia last night, they're going to be able to hold that ball late in the game should they get the opportunity to.
Yeah, if Concordia is able to hold on here, I mean, based on seeding, yeah, you would see this as an upset, but if you've watched both of these programs, you're familiar with both of these programs, it's not a surprise. I mean, Concordia has been very solid all season long. They just fell to Chapman in the SLC Conference Championship. Definitely see some heads hanging a little bit lower on the Georgia Tech sideline as they're sensing that this could very well be the end of their season. Many of these guys came back for one more year and really wanted it. Well, let's see what Coach Lovick and the boys have drawn up here. I would probably look for Ron or Barrow. We're gonna like initiate from up top here.
We got Krasicki with the ball right now. Oh,
nice.
Great action. Krasicki to Eck on that inside little route. All the eyeballs were up top. Great job by the rocket propulsion doctorate.
That's one, yeah. So, and here we go again. We talked about our keys. Are they going to roll out?
Of course they are.
Balzer with the long pole for the face-off.
Gotta make one more play in this game. 2-2. Let's go, kid.
Here it is, 22 versus 22. Poe and the long stick Balzer.
If you're Poe, you know that you're about to get your arms sawed off. So just try to find out where you can get that ball to your side and
he comes
run like heck.
It. What a kid.
Here it comes. Over the head incoming.
And I'd imagine Tech's going to pull the goalie. Look at that check.
Let's
that was
go.
A good one, too.
Let's go.
Balzer able to. Great move by Tech to put Balzer on there because, yeah, they might not have won the ball, but then you just got one of your best takeaway guys on their faceoff, man, and Balzer wins that battle. Got to push here. No time to wait. As he goes, Yang! Once again.
Uh-oh. Quarles on the ride back. I love the energy of this Georgia Tech.
And he goes for the cage.
Oh, and the 10-man's worked twice now. They got possession back both times and a great heads-up play. Man, that clear right there tells me that these guys run full field clearing drills in practices, huh?
Oh, look at
Eck getting loose in the middle there again.
Andrew Crosby with maybe what you could call the play of the day there. Saving that one.
Schneider back with the ball on his stick. But great ball pressure there from Round to get the ball back the other direction. What timeouts does Georgia Tech have left? Good soak there by Young.
Maybe one.
Yeah. Love that the coaches are letting them just play out of it, though. So you have players like these guys that are veteran players like Barrow sweeping through the middle here. Oh, and a great double team, understanding the scout on Barrow that he's a physical dodger. Eck with another great take and backup secured there.
Yeah, Beast Bo and Justin Defoe collapsing right there on Barrow, putting that ball back to the turf. Under a minute now, 43 seconds. And Yang, an athletic save, going down with that one.
And that right there.
That could do it, very well could do it.
Oh, what a shot.
Armentrout just able to get back in the net, 24 seconds.
Oh, yard sale.
And Defoe makes another beautiful.
Concordia's got to be cautious here. They don't want something to happen outside the play to affect their next competition. But we see them holding out the ball here on the other side of the field.
Emotions are high.
If I'm Coach Foss, I am taking every single one of my starters out of the game right now.
We got 5.6 seconds. It looks like this one's over, Patrick.
It does look like it is.
Concordia Eagles have pulled the upset. The number 7 seed versus the number 2 seed of the tournament.
And that'll do it. Concordia Irvine punching their ticket to the MCLA Championship Semifinals. What a great showing from Coach Foss and the Golden Eagles here as they take down Georgia Tech 14-11 here on Tuesday, second day of the MCLA tournament. It's a great game, and we're excited to continue to bring more lacrosse here in a little bit. I'm going to kick the mic over to my partner here as I go down to interview Coach Foss after that great game by the Golden Eagles.
Great job, Patrick. Yeah, what a ball game. We've been fortunate to have Concordia here 2 games in a row, and I've been very impressed with this team. Lots of offensive firepower, a lot of poise, very well coached. You could tell they really focus on fundamentals. You got to give it to Nick Beeson today. 7-goal performance. He just was lighting it up. And then also, shout out to Cade Poe, our faceoff man for the Eagles. He was just unstoppable, giving many possessions to Concordia. And let's not forget the stout defense work there with Yang leading the backbone in the goal. Stand by as Patrick Franklin will talk with Coach Foss and perhaps another player. We'll see. Signing off for now, John Robinette. Good night. We will be back here in just a bit with Liberty Flames versus the Georgia Bulldogs. Ooh, what a game.
Yeah.
Fun. Good job, refs. I think there was what, 2 penalties? Yeah, thank you guys. I think it was just the 2 penalties, like on the senior faceoff. I think there was much more than that. Oh yeah, there was that one slag.
All right, Patrick Franklin here with Coach Foss after an electric win, 14-11 for the Golden Eagles over Georgia Tech. Coach, I mean, what do you credit that to? Obviously an offensive explosion there from Beeson and some of those guys, but I think it was just a collective team effort. Would love your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think we talk all season about, right, the 3 focuses for us is being smart, being tough, being disciplined. You know, we've showed that in moments this season, and we really put it all together this game. So it was awesome to see them for 4 quarters really execute at a high level with the effort and intensity we expect. So,
yeah, absolutely. And I don't know if I was just missing something last night, but I didn't see as much of Poe last night at the faceoff X. Is that something that kind of developed throughout the day, or did you guys see a matchup that you preferred there? Because he was – I mean, if not for Nick, that was the most dominant performance, I think, of the entire game. It tilted the field in all his favor all day.
Yeah. I mean, Cade was battling an injury that he suffered in the SLC semifinals. Didn't play in the SLC finals. Not the reason we didn't perform well. But, you know, he's back from injury. He's healthy now. We were able to conserve him last night, we thought. And we thought tonight was a day that we knew he'd have a positive matchup. And obviously, Beeson played great. The guy I want to recognize is number four, Eric Abisso. He's a guy who plays short stick offense for us. He's a stud. Obviously, we had a guy go down with an injury yesterday. He stepped up, played D-middy. It was amazing on both sides of the ball for us. And
nice
definitely,
game.
for our credit, he was our MVP. So.
Awesome.
Well, Coach, it was an awesome game, and I'm excited to see you guys continue your run, man. Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, sir.
It's on us. To stop sexual assault.
To get in the way before it happens.
To get a friend home safe.
And to not blame the victim.
It's on us.
To look out for each other.
To not look the other way.
It's on us to stand up.
To step in.
To take responsibility.
It's on us, all of us.